This is my 40th year at the bar, practicing. Now, I'm going to ask before I start, this is the first opportunity I've ever had to address a jury in which I can ask the jury questions, because I think I can here. How many people in the audience today would like to see a cut in legal aid in any way at all?
This is a wrong jury.
Right, sit down then. Because if there were anybody here who would like to see cuts in it, obviously I'd address all the remaining remarks to that person. However, somebody tentatively holding their hand up there. Well, I'll pretend there's somebody here who's in that category and I'm addressing that person. And I noticed the minister didn't hold her hand up. Well, the effect, however, I think, of these proposals is going to be dramatic, however they're dressed up. And the reason I mentioned 40 years is that most of the time, most of that 40 years, some of it with Vera, in case that she's done, we've both done, has been publicly funded. 95% of the work I've done over the last 40 years has been publicly funded. So you can work it out fairly quickly. I started in the era when legal aid was coming into its own and was providing, in my view, a fundamental pillar, sometimes called the third pillar, of the welfare state, which is sometimes regarded now as a some kind of dirty word. But I'm not afraid to utter it any more than to utter the word socialism, for goodness sake. So therefore, the third pillar has not really been addressed in the same way as the other two pillars. One of them being, quite obviously, the National Health Service, which is held up as a glowing example, or was, held before internal markets and privatisation there. Held up as a glowing example to the world of how we should provide a threshold, a safety net for people's welfare. Legal welfare has not, in fact, achieved the same objective. Partly, I say straight away, it's through lawyers themselves, not, in fact, projecting an image of service and care that they should. Not all lawyers, but the legal profession, as you might imagine, still have a Dickensian image. It's very difficult to overcome that. But it has to overcome that in order to promote the message of service. And the reason I'm starting in a way with where I've come from is that when I started, not only doing publicly funded work, I was particularly interested in something that I think this government is not interested in. And that is the community. Now, it's very easy to say that. I want to spell out exactly what I mean. At the period that I began, in the early to mid-70s, there was a movement afoot here. And the movement was neighborhood law centers. They were a particularly important thing. Why? They provided, and I was a founder member of one, and a member of the national movement, as it turned out. The object was to provide for the community an accessible point at which the ordinary person who might otherwise be frightened of approaching a solicitor's office, frightened of approaching lawyers per se, has an opportunity to see a shop front in their high street which they can go to, walk in, find somebody who they can relate to, set up a relationship of trust with that person, possibly go back for ordinary things, not for the high profile. That's a very small percentage. One's dealing with housing, employment, discrimination, and law centres, obviously, as a matter of practice over the years, have not been engaged in major crime, sometimes small crime, but they refer it to local solicitors often. But it's dealing with things that matter to everyday people, creating that relationship of trust and care and service. Now, they have been, in my view, underfunded, underrated, and in fact, over the years, what I've witnessed is a decrease in the numbers, because actually they've had to rely on crisis management, on crisis funding. They've had to go back either to a local authority or the Lord Chancellor or ex gratia payments, whatever it happens to be, so that here, and I begin with this, because looking at the past, they've struggled to provide this service. There hasn't been a government going out there and saying, ah, yes, that's the key to the future. A network, a national system, which is going to provide communities with the safety net, if you like, the Judicare, which was at the basis of the Rushcliffe Committee recommendations in 1949. That has not actually been reproduced in this way. So community centres provide a good example of what's been going wrong in the system. When one looks, just briefly, you don't have to look very far at the Carter proposals, because it's astonishing that we've come from 1949 to a situation in 2005, 2006 and 2007 in which the defence, this is obviously only looking at the criminal aspect of it, I appreciate, but there's a knock-on. It's entitled The Procurement of Criminal Defence Services, smaller print, market-based reform. Now, I'm not saying tonight something I haven't said before, over the last year. And that is, if you read this report, I've got the interim one here, but the final report doesn't really matter which one you look at, there is a complete absence of consideration for those factors which can't be readily measured in economic terms, and that is what I've just been talking about. The creation of trust, the provision of a service that is local and accessible, and it may actually be quite small, because diversity isn't something that Carter or any of these proposals are really interested in. Now, what is even more fascinating is what was said by Lord Faulkner on the 28th of November, because it's building on Carter, and it's much bigger, and it's much broader, and it's been touched on already, the Legal Services Commission. The real objective here is to create a market-based legal economy which engage in those concepts you're all familiar with, economies of scale. It's not about the relationship between a small community firm, or let alone a law centre in a particular area. It's concentrating on who can give the cheapest service, because actually what it's going to condense, and it's got this extraordinary term, one's got one case, one fee, OCOF. I think you've got the point. Yes, well, anyway. The long-term objective here is that people will have to have, I say people, lawyers will have to assemble in conglomerates, basically, because the only way you're going to be able to cross the financial threshold of having enough work to justify the tender or the bid that you're going to put in and the franchise that you'll get back is to show you've got enough people and enough experience so you know who's going to go to the wall, don't you? It's, well, in another analogy, it's the corner shop. It's the smaller person. It's the person who actually cares for the community in which they live. The bigger firms, yeah, the commercial firms, I'm sure they'll start to mop it up and so forth. And there may be tweaks and so forth here and there to adjust it to local circumstances, this new scheme. But make no mistake about it, it's sometimes referred to as harmonisation. That's the term that's being used. That's the cuddly, friendly word they're introducing in order to make you feel that actually we are attending to this question of diversity, this question of trust, and so on.